Thanks for listening to the Von Haessler Doctrine podcast. Remember, you can hear the show every weekday from 9 to noon right here on 95.5 WSB, Atlanta's news and talk. Live from Sherwood Forest in the heart of Atlanta, Georgia, hour one of the Von Haessler Doctrine begins right now. I am your lovable, huggable, mid-morning chat host, Eric Von Haessler, surrounded by the Doctrinaires, man of a thousand voices, Tim Andrews, is here. Lady of quite a few voices in her own right, Autumn Fisher is here. And of course, the handsomest producer in all of producery, Jared Yamamoto, is here.
Good morning, Eric.
I'm surprised you haven't hit me with the old Friday the 13th thing.
Well, I think that there are some things in store with that.
I know what you mean by that. That means when we get to the headlines and stuff like that, there'll be some sort of weird... what's funny is I will be interested to see if he makes the same mistake he made the first year. He decided to hit with the Friday the 13th, like the Doctrine lady says, it's Friday the headlines for Friday the 13th, and then the music he used was not from the movie Friday the 13th, but was from Halloween.
Yes,
and I still stand by that, because October, and it was
all that, this week we have Friday the 13th and the snow moon. How about that?
Oh, it's a little too much. I almost can't make it. I was reading that I find all this stuff to be absolutely absurd. If I could find a hotel who had a 13th floor, I would stay there. I don't have any problem. I see that I was looking that apparently FDR had a fear of the number 13 and wouldn't allow it in certain speeches and things like that. Stephen King is a, whatever it's called,
Triskaidekaphobia.
There you go. And it's just, to me, I just want to say something to people. having a fear of numbers is absurd. It's idiotic.
Yeah.
It's moronic. Numbers are concepts, and I'm not going to get into the whole damn thing, for heaven's sakes.
I mean, it's kind of like being afraid of, buttons.
Oh, well, listen. Buttons, however, buttons are real, right?
Yeah.
You could swallow buttons. You could choke and die
on
buttons.
That's not why someone's afraid of buttons.
I understand crawl out that. Of the cup and kill you.
We should explain. We should explain that Tim Andrews has a fear of not buttons on his shirt, but he doesn't like to see buttons gathered in a jar. And they freak him out.
Yeah, and I'm like, well, who has buttons in it?
But I mean, at least what I say is, okay, that's silly, but I mean, they're real, they're buttons, and for some reason you have some sort of association. The idea of being afraid of a number is just absolutely absurd. I'm sorry. I don't care if you're Stephen King or FDR or what.
Now, I think there's a pass for the number zero, though, because zero is a concept. It's not really a thing.
I was saved by zero.
She was saved by zero when there were red skies at night.
Yeah.
One thing leads to another, man.
You're not going to get any more fix references on any other show in America than you got there. I can guarantee you that. So don't be silly. Don't be the whole concept.
Don't be a nincompoop.
I mean, why is it the hotels don't have 13th floors? Not because the people who build them really think something awful will happen there. They just know that you will not book a room on the 13th floor. So it's on you. I have said it before, and I'll say it again. I am willing to walk under a ladder, smash a mirror while a black cat walks past me.
No, Eric, don't do it.
And I will tell you this. If I got some kind of horrible news 5 minutes later, you still wouldn't be able to convince me that it had anything to do with walking under the ladder, smashing the mirror, and seeing the black cat walk by. It is silly. It's absurd. It's time to grow up. Happy Friday the 13th. Now let's get to Jared's goofy headlines cart. Do it.
Headlines for Friday, December 13th. Ooh, it's Friday the 13th.
No,
not as bad.
Ooh, it's Friday the 13th.
I like that.
Ooh.
Doctrine voice lady switched it up a little bit
there. Yes, she did. I like that.
Ooh.
You like that doctrine voice lady. You're a fan of Friday the 13th. What are you saying there?
Ooh.
That's her response to the number 13.
Ooh.
Better than being afraid. Do they think, I've always wondered with hotels that don't have a 13th floor, you're really not giving, okay, if you believe in bad luck, and that it somehow is drawn toward the number 13,
then you're not giving it much credit. Like, you're saying it can't count. Like, bad luck would show up looking for a 13th floor and go, 11, 12, 14. Well, I guess there's no 13 here.
Guess I'll find another building to collapse.
Here's the secret, folks. The 14th floor is the 13th floor.
Yeah.
And if bad luck actually knows how to find 13, it knows how to figure out that you're trying to get one over on it.
You're revealing too much, Eric. You realize now people, nobody's going to stay on the 14th floor now.
Yeah, just say, you know what? Just don't go above 12. All right, what do you got?
All right, Republicans erupted last night as Judiciary...
They erupted?
Yeah, as Judiciary Chairman Jerry Nadler suddenly postponed the impeachment vote right around midnight.
Now, they went on and on and on. You know, we were gonna have all of this these hearings live all night long, and then about 9:30 we ducked out. We couldn't believe it was continuing. And so basically what happened at the end is Nadler realized that if we pass the articles of impeachment at midnight or whatever time it was, there's not going to be a lot of press for it. It's going to be old news by the time we get to tomorrow. So he gaveled it closed and said, I want everyone to go home and consult their conscience. As if there's anybody who doesn't know what they're going to do here. And so it's either that. It's either that he just wanted to bring it back so they can pass him at like 1 or 2 in the afternoon and get a full day of coverage out of it. Or maybe he's worried he doesn't have enough Democrats. They've got enough Democrats, but they don't want to lose too many Democrats because that won't look good either. So you got some audio. You have him talking about it, Nadler, when he delays the vote.
I want the members on both sides of the aisle to think about what has happened over these last 2 days.
Go to your room.
And to search their consciences before we cast our final votes.
That sounds like when you tell your son to go to his room and just come out when he's ready.
Yeah, you know?
Why your son?
Why? Because I have a son. That's why.
Oh, I thought she was just meaning in general. It was only. Your son gets sent back to a room.
No. I'm a great parent in some ways and a terrible parent in other ways. But one of the good ways is that when your kids are just. Well, you don't, Jared, because you're still a kid. But Tim, you've never had any. So
I'm a man child.
What happens with kids is sometimes they just start having bad days and they just can't handle anything. And they're these torpedoes that are just looking to ruin everything for everybody. And when that happens and there's no rhyme or reason to it, rather than spanking or go to your room until I tell you to come out, my whole thing, and this works, I would send my son to his room and tell him, you come out when you feel like you're ready to be a member of this family and not cause trouble. And that's a great thing because it gives them a situation. You know, he's still mad when he goes in there. He doesn't know why. He can work it out. Most of the times, by the time he came out, he was fine. I think a couple of times he came out a little bit too soon. I had to go, hey, you're not ready. Go back in. But it gives them the chance to decide for themselves, make their own decision. Not you're in there for an hour and then you can come out. You're in there until you decide you can handle being a part of this family again. So that's why I did that. Not to delay the vote so I could get better press. Like this Jerry Nadler, for heaven's sakes. Now, it went really late, and I tried to watch a little bit of it in the afternoon, but I have to tell you, I just don't have any patience for watching politicians go through their kabuki theater on either side. You're not inspiring me, okay? Wake me up when there's a vote. Tell me when something has actually happened. Watching the process of these people that we call politicians go through their process, even if I think one side should win and the other should lose, I find the whole thing to be absurd. You'd like for two people who disagree but are honest just to go up there and honestly disagree and then go for it. But on one side, we've decided that the narrative for the day is this. Well, the counter narrative that we want to, I don't have time for it. You know, go for your sheep that you're handling out there. I don't have time for it. So I don't know. It may be that the Republicans were actually pushing a lot of stuff into the agenda to make it go later so that it wouldn't get a lot of press. I don't know. And this was Nadler's response. Either way, it had nothing to do with people consulting their conscience about this stuff. And right there, it's just like, oh, get out of here. Stop with the phony, baloney, self-righteous nonsense. Nobody believes that you really, like, went to the bathroom 10 minutes earlier on the way back, had an epiphany. You know what? This is a big decision. I think people need to consult their conscience. People are getting so sick and tired of political speak. They wonder why people put up with Trump's excesses in his personality. because he gives it to you. It just comes out. He has no filter. And that has its own downside. I'm not saying it doesn't. But people are so tired of that. Nobody really believes that Nadler had an idea at the last minute.
I want the members on both sides of the aisle to think about what has happened over these last 2 days and to search their consciences before we cast our final votes.
We had our pollsters poll it, and searching conscience, it looks pretty good, so I'll go out there and pretend that's why. Just be honest. This is a big deal, and we want better press for it. So we're going to come back tomorrow.
We only have bloggers in here right now, so please go home. Tomorrow, wear a nice suit, comb your hair. You from Texas, don't wear that dumb hat. Come tomorrow.
And again, it doesn't matter what you think of Trump. You love him or you hate him. That has nothing to do with the fact that Gerald Nadler did not gavel that session closed for that reason. And that's what people are just sick of, sick and tired of. And we'll get to England soon, and you're seeing it over there as well.
Well, that's why here on WSB, what we're going to do with our coverage today is once the Judiciary Committee actually votes on it, we will carry the vote live today on WSB.
Yeah. Enough of the process. Hey, you know what? There's Trey Young is tired of the process, and WSB is tired of the process. We'll get to you with the answers. Do you have the moment when, number one, when Collins, this is after Gerald Nadler suddenly decides they're not going to vote.
You chose not to consult the ranking member on a schedule issue of this magnitude?
Really? So typical.
This is the kangaroo court that we're talking about.
She's outrageous.
It's more Stalin-esque than
unbelievable.
Not even consult.
All right, I don't know if the Stalin-esque. Come on, Republicans. You don't need to go in that direction with the over everything's Hitler and Stalin. I don't. And
nobody even knows Stalin.
Yeah, Stalin. What the hell? There's probably people are. No Post Malone better than they know Stalin.
Probably.
I will tell you why I put those two together. It's really, really something that people listening to us will not understand. But okay. Go ahead.
British voters delivered a stunning victory to Prime Minister Boris Johnson and his Conservative Party yesterday.
This was big. This was big. You have Boris. Let me tell you what happened over there. And if you remember, the fact that Brexit passed to begin with, 2020 being hindsight, was a clue that the unthinkable here by everyone who told you it was going to happen. Over there, it was, well, no, there's no way they'll leave Europe. And then Brexit happened. Well, there's no way this Donald Trump can win. And then Donald Trump won. It's a little bit of the same wave where people are sick and tired of, you know what people are tired of? The same people that Time magazine put on their cover and called them the Guardians. People are sick and tired of the so-called guardians, the keepers of the flame, the diplomats, the bureaucrats, all of this. And it has to do here and over in England. Same thing. Now, I think the Democrats, I wonder if Nadler gaveled it closed because he saw that Boris Johnson won so mightily over there. There is an analog to what's going on here. And it was the same thing. Well, after Brexit happened, well, a lot of people didn't go vote, and a lot of people are wondering, and they'd like to do it again. They got a chance to do it again, basically, with this vote. And Boris Johnson and the Tories now have more seats in Parliament than they've had since Margaret Thatcher in the early 80s. Labour has the least amount of seats in Parliament since the 1930s. There's a lot of analog here between what's happening here. A lot of people in the middle, swing voters, independent voters, people like that, are not enamored with Donald Trump's personal style. All right? But they don't want to be socialist. A lot of people over there could take or leave Brexit, quite frankly. But when it came time to vote, the question was more than Brexit. Do you like Brexit or do you like Boris Johnson? It was, well, if we go the other way, this guy Jeremy Corbyn is a big-time leftist socialist, and that's the tipping thing. Same thing could happen next year. Same thing could happen next year if you end up with a Bernie Sanders or Elizabeth Warren type who is running against Trump. An awful lot of people in the middle who are not enamored with Trump and haven't gone to a rally or would be perfectly fine with some sort of centrist Democrat are going to go toward Trump, mostly to keep socialism from ruining an economy that's on fire. There's a lot of there's a lot of, now a lot can happen between now and next November, but I see in the tea leaves here, it's very much the same. A lot of people could possibly vote for Trump who don't really like his personal style, because the alternative is socialism, which Americans are not ready for. I know that all of the press is trying to tell us how much we're ready for it, but we're not convinced by our 28-year-old enlightened generation. I'm sorry. We still think it's not a good idea. So you have Boris.
Yeah, here's him doing his victory lap.
Well, do the five before four.
We did it. We pulled it off, didn't we? We pulled it off. We broke the deadlock. We ended the gridlock. We smashed the roadblock. And in this glorious, glorious pre-breakfast moment, before a new dawn rises on a new day and a new government.
And they made a, I guess it was very early in the morning and everybody wanted to eat.
Let's get Brexit done. But first, my friends, let's get breakfast done too. Thank you all.
Also, by the way, he was a great campaigner, unlike May before him. He knew how to go out and campaign. Candidates matter.
Get your daily dose of comic relief with Eric Von Haessler mornings at 9. Then shake off the daily stress.
And it's gonna be all right.
With Mark Arum weeknights at 6 on 95.5 WSB.
Yeah, pulling muscles from a shell. Squeeze.
Never thought it would happen with me.
Do you have any Ello?
Ooh.
Tim Andrews yesterday, he's making a joke because at the end of the podcast 30, was it?
Oh, I thought it was on air. Sorry.
I can't remember, but...
it was in the podcast 30.
You were, Jared was telling us who was appearing somewhere, and he said, Ello. he meant the Electric Light Orchestra.
I was playing music off of my soundboard, and
Ello.
That's all I had in
hey,
front of
look,
me.
Hey, look, there's Ello. Oh. But I got to say, for him, he's into EDM and all that. That sounds like an EDM True. Artist.
Yeah,
Ello.
It really does.
DJ Ello.
DJ Ello. All right, what do you got for me?
Taylor Swift slammed toxic male privilege and Scooter Braun in her big Billboard Women of the Decade speech.
People need to understand, Scooter Braun, he's also Justin Bieber's manager, or was. He bought her music. She was bidding for it. He bought it, and she's very angry about it. This has happened before. Paul McCartney was bidding for the Beatles. Michael Jackson didn't care, outbid him. This has happened to people before. She's been very angry about it. And then so she gets an award as the Woman of the Year for Billboard or whatever.
Woman of the Decade.
Woman of the Decade. Well, yeah. She should be happy, but she's never happy. And so we'll go ahead.
And let me just say that the definition of the toxic male privilege in our industry is people saying, but he's always been nice to me. When I'm raising valid concerns about artists and their rights to own their music. And of course he's nice to you. If you're in this room, you have something he needs.
You know, Taylor Swift is 30 years old. She's worth $360 million. She's wildly talented. It seems to me that things have worked out for her. But she's always a victim. Also, if you want to get across an idea, use your own words. If you're going to use buzz phrases and buzzwords like male, toxic, you know, Justin Bieber is on the side of Scooter Braun. So to believe Taylor Swift, I have to believe that Justin Bieber is a toxically masculine male. I'm not buying that. Why don't you guys correct me when I'm wrong?
I didn't know you were wrong.
I was taking my walk around the campus, and I realized that was not Pulling Muscles from a Shell, that Squeeze song. That was Up the Junction.
Ah.
A different one.
I knew it, but yeah, I didn't want to tell you.
Yeah. Not my favorite Squeeze song. A little too wordy, a little too Harry Chapin for me with the story.
Yeah. I love it. It sounds like John Lennon singing.
Yeah. Well, that's Squeeze anyway, but I don't know. Just a little too wordy on
there. She's gonna be an actress.
Harry Chapin. Once you hear the song, you've read the book. You gotta go back and listen to it 17 times. All right. You didn't end up being a pilot or whatever.
I got stoned in my taxi.
Hey, Clark's Christmas Kids continues today. Clark and I will be at the Walmart on Windward Parkway in Alpharetta. And Smiling Mark and Scott Slade will be at the Walmart in Buford. That's Sardis Church Road.
That's right.
In Buford. Broadcast will start three to seven, taking your donations beginning at 2. And the complete schedule of events and Walmart locations you can find at WSBRadio.com. Jared's going to show up around 5 o'clock, I think.
That's right. I'll be there right after you.
We can give each other a high five as we pass the torch.
I'll be on deck. Well, you're batting. I'm on deck.
See, now this makes me competitive. I have to get more people to come in and buy presents for foster kids than Jared Yamamoto.
Well, I actually go and I give hugs to the listeners. I'm nice to them. You like to stay kind of behind
there. No, that's not true at all. I'm always out there with the peeps.
Sick. I don't want to shake your head.
Well, last time I was genuinely infectious.
I remember our listeners' names, too. You come up and you're like, I know you look familiar.
I don't remember people in my family's names, so I don't think that can be held against me. Let's do this.
He's a misanthrope. He has a dark heart. And he needs a good psychiatrist.
New York.
It's Greg Russ with stories from Studio B1.
All right, Gregory, how are you on this Friday the 13th?
I'm doing well. I'd like to point out that you didn't know my name. Just to illustrate your point, you didn't know my name for at least 6 months.
That is true. That is true. Greg was an intern at that other show. I was on some other show for a while. And Greg was an intern there. And yeah, I basically ignored you for a good long time, didn't I? I don't know why. I thought he was just kind of a
beads,
slacker.
Wasn't it?
Yeah, it's my initial idea.
They weren't beads. They were ball bearings.
Even ball worse. Bearings and hemp necklace, yeah. And a choker kind of thing, and a.
You knew he was there for the other member of your show.
Yeah, that's true. He was there not for me, for somebody else.
Well, look, here's what happened. I didn't get in your business. I just sat there and I was relatively quiet.
That's right.
And then at some point, that's how you win people over.
You know, it did work. Hey, we're friends all these years later. And
if I were in there, it's like, hey, Eric, I got an idea. Eric, hey, I thought about this last night. Eric, let me do this.
Yeah.
Hey, take this to the show. Bring it up.
Yeah, believe me, we've had a couple interns like that, and Jared is put on the job very quickly to keep them away from me.
Hey, I do Trump, too.
Oh, yeah, we had that guy for a while. All right, what do you got for Studio
Bless his heart. Bless his heart.
Listen, hey, well, you know what? Merry Christmas to everybody who has been an intern here. I love you all.
Did you even give him a chance to do the Trump? You know, even if Tim
is
the
best. No, I put my headphones on.
No, I don't. No.
I'm just saying that, you know, the training camp sometimes competition is good.
No. I didn't even. I thought that it was an insult, actually, even attempt to do that in front of the great Tim Andrews.
Thank you.
Now, what do you have? What do you have?
Exciting news. Magic mushrooms have passed the first hurdle as a depression treatment.
Sweet.
Magic mushrooms.
The active ingredient. It's not really an ingredient, is it? It's not like someone's baking this thing.
One cup of psilocybin.
It's the agent that causes the magic, right?
Yeah, psilocybin.
Yeah. So now I would imagine this is in very small doses. You're not, you know, not sending you on a 6-hour trip to get over your depression. I would imagine it's just a little bit, right?
Microdosing. Some people do this with mushrooms themselves.
I know. In Silicon Valley, this is a big thing with the CEOs and everything. They call it microdosing. But I just think, like, they'll take little microdoses of mushrooms before they go and give, like, a TED Talk or something. And I would have too much of a fear that, well, I might get that one part of the mushroom where there's a whole lot more. Like, how do I know it's all evenly maybe concentrated in one area, I freak out?
Given the amount you have to ingest to actually have a trip, a little itty-bitty thing like that would not mess you up.
So is this something that is not just a bunch of hippies talking? It's actual psychiatrists, I take it? Not psychologists, because they can't give prescriptions.
No, they're there just to listen to you talk and nod their heads and say,
drone on and on and on, and then give you a bill.
Yes, it's what a racket.
It's called the talking therapy, popularized by Sigmund Freud. Yeah,
no, I enjoy it too. It's changed my life, Eric.
It's a little bit, I will tell you this, it's a little bit, as we become more secular, it's a little bit like a Catholic religion has that. You know, going to confession on Sunday is a little bit of the talking therapy. It's kind of the same thing. So it's good for people to talk things out. And I guess now if you microdose at the same time, you'll talk away all your blues.
Well, there's a change in sensory perception and a positive mood boost. That's what happens in these smaller doses. So, you know, anything that creates that, of course, it's going to treat depression. I don't know why this is such a surprise.
Yeah, I know.
It's like, oh, boost your mood?
Well, for years and years and years, we just weren't even able to go into these areas and see if these, because we just think of them as hippie drugs and people tripping and walking into traffic and jumping off
of buildings.
The stigma
is what you're saying.
Exactly. And so you weren't able to go in there like everything else in nature and find out if there's anything at any dosage that could help somebody. And that's changing now with the people.
I'm taking ayahuasca for my psoriasis.
Yeah. Well, you tell me about your third eye.
Yeah. I saw the big snake, and I never felt so... Well, I still had psoriasis.
Doesn't people, yeah, but you still, you don't care anymore. Yeah.
Wow, but it was amazing.
The ayahuasca thing is like, people say, oh, well, okay, the first time you vomit. Okay, I'm out.
Well, that's how you get it going. Yeah, you gotta vomit to really see the snake.
You gotta be in a hut with a bunch of Peruvians, you know?
This is the thing. Anything where you need a guide, any kind of drug use, where there's a guide involved, I don't really want to go there.
You know what I like?
My drug Sherpa.
I like
because you can't trust yourself. Yeah, this is the thing. You need the drug Sherpa to make sure you don't kill yourself or kill someone else. Yeah.
I'm a simple man. I like a nice beer on a Saturday afternoon. Seems to relax me, but you know.
A slow stone.
A slow stone. Just keep yourself steady. Don't go too far. Don't go over the top. No need to have a hangover the next day. Just enjoy yourself.
Be the tortoise in the race to oblivion.
Moderation in all things is what I say. Right, Greg? You're a moderate person, don't you think?
Yes. If anything, I lean too far into moderation. It becomes scarcity.
Yeah, because if you take it far enough, that thought, moderation in all things, .. including moderation. Where does that take you? You got to be extreme every once in a while in order to moderate your moderation.
Well, let's pull out those magic mushrooms and we can explore that idea.
Yeah. Well, I'm not a depressant type, so I don't need your so-called mad. I don't like mushrooms. I'm not a fan of mushrooms,
like mushrooms,
even in food or anything like that. I don't need a drug Sherpa. I don't need a drug guide. I don't want to find out. Like you hear, like this guy Joe Rogan, who has a great podcast, but he's always talking about these, you know, and the third eye, and there were shadow people. I don't want to meet the shadow people.
They're friendly.
I don't care. I don't want to know. All I want to do is just put my feet up and say, hey, that was a good week's work. I'm enjoying myself here in my
Let me guide
backyard.
You through these fractals, Eric.
Yeah, I don't want to see fractals either. It's not my style.
I do like the idea of you coming across someone who's offering you a magic mushroom, and that is your reason to not take it. It's like, I just don't like mushrooms.
I won't even eat I look at cans of soup and read all those ingredients to make sure that mushrooms is not one of them. I hate them. Mushrooms, to me, food mushrooms, non-magic mushrooms, are, I just can't, the sight of them, I can't stand them, the idea of putting them in my mouth.
Those ones that are like those little capped ones that are whole in things, those are disgusting.
If they're dry, they're like dirt. If they're wet, they're like mud. I just don't want to. And,
people are so good for you.
I don't give a damn.
What do they do for you? How are they good for you?
They shroom you up.
Yeah.
Make you less depressed. Aren't you listening to the story?
Oh, yeah, that's right.
Magic mushrooms. Magic city. The magic city mushrooms.
Oh, yeah.
Make it rain.
Yeah, make it rain all over me.
It's raining happiness.
It's silver. It's blue.
All right, what else you got?
The people of Mesa, Arizona are in a frenzy.
Oh, I have a friend who lived in Mesa, Arizona. I think he still does.
Well, there's a frenzy going on right there.
Yeah.
Right now.
Maybe it's my buddy.
Because there was a bright orb seen hovering over the city. And it dropped flares at some point.
Yeah, okay, so it's some kind of thing that we're not being told about by the military.
Well, the military has their base, and they said, that's not us. That wasn't our
thing. Of course, what are they supposed to say about secret things? I don't know.
What are you doing, Tim? This is right up your alley. Suddenly you're becoming rational.
Well, I don't want to get it from the other side here.
No, I'm just saying. I don't know what it is, but I'm going to tell you what it isn't. It's not aliens from another world.
Dimension.
Why not? Mesa was where they would pick?
Yeah, sure.
Clearly.
Mesa.
Of all the places on this planet.
Yeah, why go to Phoenix?
They got a good taco stand there.
That's all I can tell you.
Yeah, they got tongue tacos. You ever try this tongue tacos?
Lengua. Yes, delicious.
Oh, disgusting.
Tongue taco with mushrooms, Eric, and onions.
Ooh.
Mm-mm.
It's like a cheesesteak, but with cheeks and tongue.
Yes.
Disgusting.
And this is what the aliens, they come down in their orb.
We don't
get these tacos.
I don't want to taste anything that's tasting me back.
Pig cheeks. Mmm.
Not in food, anyway.
Yeah, okay.
Next. You gotta lay sideways.
Okay.
It's not aliens, I can tell you that. I don't know what it is. Don't ask me what it is. It's a light in the sky, but it's not aliens from some other planet.
So the military base, you should have been there in person, because they said that it wasn't them, but then they looked at the camera and they winked earlier.
Oh, yeah.
Wink.
I know. Yeah. I don't know. It may not be a military thing. It might be. A lot of times it ends up being a couple things that come together, like a weather balloon plus some sort of...
And St. Elmo's fire.
St. Elmo's fire.
That's what they tell you.
I like when you Google the story. I typed in Mesa Orb, and then there's a news story. And in the news story, the image is a fleet of alien ships.
Yeah, that's what it is.
Well,
I can't believe von Haessler isn't believing that this is a fleet of alien ships, clearly.
In the story, guys, there's an eyewitness. Carrie Burnett said it was, quote, a pretty bright light. It was straight up over here, and it went that way, stopped, and it didn't seem like it was going too much further.
They say Goodyear on the side, but I don't know where it came from. it's not aliens, people. It's just I can tell you what it's not. I can't tell you what it is.
These news stories now, the fact that they do use stock photos that are outrageous. Photographer's gone. Freelance photographers for news stories gone.
That's
just find something on the web. It's a fleet of UFOs.
The web stories, they always have the most innocuous photos. They're stock photos. Mm-hmm. And it's always like when it's Valentine's Day, it's like a girl opening up a thing. It's like, this is no girl anywhere. This has nothing to do with the story. Things are just going downhill when it comes to telling stories.
There was one yesterday where they did they did one about Native Americans, and the social media person used a white chick from Bonnaroo. from Burning Man.
Burning Man.
It's the same thing. It's the same thing quickly. I know the music, but it's like a story about a peeping Tom, and then there's just some guy who is the one who's plastered up there.
Yeah. Or anything about internet hacking is just the numbers and green across the screen. We were talking off air. Greg, I don't know if you do this, but... judging a book by a cover, I don't know that I do that so much, but I do, like, certain names. If I don't know the people and they're actors or whatever, I'll go, I don't see that movie. There's this actress. I like old movies. But there's this actress. Her name is Virginia Mayo. I don't know why. When I hear that name, I'm like, I don't want to see that movie.
It turns you off.
I don't know why. I have no idea why.
You don't like Mayo?
Well she's a looker.
I'm a big fan of mayonnaise. I enjoy mayonnaise. There's just something about that name. I don't want to see that movie, Virginia Mayo. She might be the greatest actress of all time, for all I know.
Ginny Miracle Whip.
Her sister.
Yeah.
I judge every book by its cover. Any people I see on the street, just immediately have a whole backstory for them. I don't like them.
Yeah, I know that about you. So I think I'm not. I just have a touch of it. For some reason, Virginia Mayo is the only victim of
also,
my judging things by cover.
Literal book covers, very important. That really does help. Sometimes you look at a book, if you don't know what you're looking for, and you find a book cover that's no good, you put the book back, the content inside.
Yeah, you know what? My radio guru consultant is—he's telling me I can see what you're saying. Is that nobody buys books anymore? What are we talking about?
Come on, let's move on. People don't know what he's talking about. Get an audiobook, maybe. Kindle, whatever.
Do you like the audiobooks? I know you're a big reader. Do you like the audiobooks, Greg?
No, I enjoy reading. I haven't given them a chance, so maybe I should. But I enjoy reading.
I like the audiobooks because I have a dull in my brain. I'm a dull reader. My wife reads out loud to kids and things, and like she really gets into it. But I realize I'm a very dull reader. Very in my mind, it's very monotone. And it's kind of cool when somebody is an actor or theater person and they really bring it to life. But my problem with audiobooks is my mind begins to drift, even if it's a good book. And then I realize I've been thinking about something else for four minutes. I got to go back.
Yep. But then they also get to set the character for you. I like creating in my mind what the character sounds like.
Well, you're right.
How they present themselves.
Yeah. If they do go to extreme with a character, like, well, hello! I'm not seeing that guy like that. All right, Greg Russ, are you going to join us with Podcast 30 or no?
No, I'm not going to make it today. I'm sorry.
All right. Well, we'll talk to you next week. Thank you, sir.
Have a good weekend.
All right, we'll have continuing team coverage of this throughout the day and what happens next, so be sure and stay with WSB. For now, let's go back to Eric von Haessler and the crew.
You know, I can be proven wrong on this. It's going to take until next November, but I think that the Democrats just sealed their fate. I'm saying this objectively. I just don't think that this is a winner, and I don't think anybody's surprised. And when you put on top of it, and I don't know how many people are going to follow this part of it, but... They had meetings yesterday and they debated all of this for hours and hours and hours. And then it got so late and they were going to vote on the Articles of Impeachment. And Nadler said, he gaveled the thing closed and said, I want people to think about this overnight. Well, when it was, we're going to get back together tomorrow at 10 o'clock in the morning. Well, by 10:15, it's all done. So that lets you know what that was all about. All the best anchors were in bed sleeping at the time that they would have done it at last night if it would have happened at midnight or something along those lines. And they made the decision. Now let's break. Let's come back tomorrow at 10 so that you can have a full news cycle, a full day of news where this can be featured. So I think we'll see. It's very difficult to predict politics, especially when you're a year out. But my gut feeling is they just sealed their fate here. If you saw what happened in England overnight and the way people are thinking and the changes and what people are tired of from their ruling classes, I think that this falls right in there. I have not run into anybody outside of newsrooms that are even talking about impeachment. I remember when I was a kid, when they were leading up to the impeachment of Nixon, he resigned before it could happen, but Watergate and everything that led up there, the Vietnam War had trouble getting on the front page. I mean, everybody was talking about it. It was a big deal. And even with Clinton, although a little bit of the same thing, where people realized he wasn't going to be removed, and most people felt that the Republicans overplayed their hand on it. I think this one's going to land as being really tone deaf from where the people are. But look, a week is a year in politics. So a year is, what would that be? That would be 520 years in politics. So a lot can happen between now and then. But that's my gut feeling is everybody who voted yes doesn't have a friend who would have voted no. Everyone they know and everyone they talk to hate the president so much that this had to be done. My guess is with most people in the country and importantly, the swing voter, the independent, you know, you have the people who hate Trump. They're not going to move. And the people who love Trump, they're not going to move. This is all about the way Trump won with like 1% or less in Pennsylvania, Wisconsin, Michigan. I think to that crowd, this seems completely tone deaf. Nobody outside of activist type people have been walking around for the last 3 months since they found out about, because remember, this is supposed to have nothing to do with Russia and collusion. This is all about a phone call to the president of Ukraine. And I just don't think that that matches anybody anywhere in America who for the last couple of months, all they could talk about is, oh, that phone call was so bad. People understood what was going on with Nixon. People, you break in, you cover up the fact that your people broke into an office and stole things. That's very easy to get your mind around, and people could talk about, oh, hey, I like Nixon, but they shouldn't be breaking into the opposition's headquarters. It's very easy to understand. Even the Clinton stuff, because it was salacious, was easy to understand. And people were talking about Clinton, most of them saying he shouldn't be impeached for it, but they were still talking about it. They knew what it was. I have heard no conversation where people have decided, I'll tell you, I'm calling my representative because that phone call that Trump made to that Ukrainian president, I mean, he needs to be impeached. That I don't find that to be the will of the people. Again, it's hard to call these things. A lot of us didn't think Donald Trump could be elected, so it's very difficult to call these things. That's my gut reaction to this, is they're overplaying their hand, and I don't know how much they can pay for it. I'm beginning to wonder if all the Democratic senators will actually vote, will stay lockstep. I don't, you know.
There's some that are very vulnerable.
Well, they're beyond even being, yeah, if they're vulnerable, they know he's not going to be removed. Why take the hit? So I don't see this as the will of the people. I see this as the will of the Congress, of the House of Representatives, but I don't know that it represents...
It's the will of Twitter.
It might be the will of some very rich people who got in touch with Nancy Pelosi and said, if you want my money next time around, you better impeach this SOB. That's a possibility.
Yeah. Just in case you missed it, this was carried live here on WSB. There's going to be a ton of campaign ads that come out with this
statement. Mr. Chairman, there are 23 ayes and 17 noes.
The article is agreed to. The resolution is amended as ordered, reported favorably to the House. Members will have 2 days to submit views. The resolution will be reported as a single amendment in the nature of a substitute. Without objection, staff is authorized to make technical and conforming changes. Without objection, the committee is adjourned.
Mr. Chairman, pursuant to
what purpose does the gentleman seek recognition?
Pursuant to Clause 2L of Rule 11, I give notice of intent to file dissenting views.
Notice is heard. Without objection, the committee is adjourned.
Yeah, just like that. And I would venture to guess, this is pure speculation, I would venture to guess that most people, if you stopped them and said, did you hear the president got impeached today? Yeah, I heard that. And if you ask them why, I'll bet you most of them think it has to do with the Russian collusion. I'll bet you most people are not truly aware of the phone call and the issue because it's all been kind of mixed together. So, we'll see how it all plays out. I told you days ago, we know what's going to happen. The House of Representatives, now this is going to go to the floor whenever it gets there. He said something about 2 days, so my guess is it's not going to get there on Monday. They'll vote, and they may not get all the Democrats. They're going to get enough, and he's going to be impeached by the House. By the way, so that people understand this, he's not been impeached yet. This was a vote to get it out of committee, to get it to the floor, so that the full House can vote on it. And then he'll be impeached. There'll be a trial. He won't be removed. And all that matters for all the bluster and all the talking points and all the pundits you're going to see over the next year, all that matters is how does it land at the ballot box next November? And we'll find out. You know, this is very interesting. So they just voted the Articles of Impeachment out of committee. CNN, Fox News is running the Republican press conference, all the congressional Republicans giving a press conference. It's wrapping up right now. CNN is doing a panel. MSNBC is talking to an expert. Now, here's my question. When Jerry Nadler comes out and the Democrats give their press conference, is CNN going to have a big panel and just keep on talking over them? Or do you think they're going to go to that press conference? That's amazing. These people act as we know it's not true, but there's supposed to be this thing about, oh, you know, we're neutral. We're just giving you the news. Who decided that the moment after articles of impeachment are voted out of committee, who decided at CNN and MSNBC that the Republicans on that committee holding a press conference together was not newsworthy? And what was the reason that it was decided that that was not newsworthy? I'm not talking about ratings worthy. I'm not talking about pandering to our base worthy. I'm talking about newsworthy. Articles of impeachment have just been voted out of the Democrat House committee, and immediately thereafter, Republican Congress members hold a press conference, and both CNN and MSNBC would have us believe, because not MSNBC, let's just deal with CNN, who tries to pretend that they're not MSNBC, would have us believe by their own logic, in their newsroom, there was a decision that was made that the Republican press conference was not newsworthy. Remember, not that we're not interested or we don't care or we don't believe anything they're going to say. A decision was made that it was not worth covering. It wasn't newsworthy. My question will be later on, whenever it happens, when Nadler gives his press conference. I mean, after all, CNN, between CNN and MSNBC, they've got 18 to 20 pundits on their panels. You put them together. I mean, you could do two NBA teams with a full bench and some coaches. Will they let them continue to talk? My guess is that they'll take the Democrat press conference. And no matter how you vote, that should bother the hell out of you. Not so much with MSNBC, although my guess is that Fox News will also cover the Democrat press conference. And we know that they're to the right. My guess is they will have covered both. Maybe just because Republicans went first and they're kind of on the hook. But CNN needs to just drop it. Stop acting like you're not MSNBC. You're Fox's opposition. Own it. By deciding that a press conference is not newsworthy moments after this historic event happened, you're MSNBC light. That's worse than being MSNBC.
Wow. Dio, rock and roll Christmas.
Ronnie James Dio is from Cortland, New York.
Yes, he is.
And I was in a comedy group, and we used to travel all around New York State and Pennsylvania. We go through Cortland, and I was reminded every time I went through Cortland that it was famous for two things at that time, being the birthplace of Ronnie James Dio and being the incest capital of America. Now, I think they lost the second title to some other small town.
Towanda, Pennsylvania.
Yes, possibly. Now we're living after the articles of impeachment. By the way, he's not impeached yet, people. That will happen. But the voting of the articles of impeachment out of committee. And It's interesting to me, you know, the criticism when you see all these pundit panels on the 24-hour news networks, the criticism of Trump has been, just in terms of electoral politics, getting reelected, he plays too much to his base. He doesn't seem to realize that he already has his base, and he's always doubling down with his base, and he doesn't realize that you have to expand that. You got to bring people in. So he won't get reelected because he's always playing to his base. Well, what did the Democrats just do with this impeachment? Hey, look, the people who hate Trump and can't stand Trump and are disgusted by Trump, the Democrats already had. Their hatred of Trump is enough. It's going to get them out to the polls next November. You couldn't keep them in their house. To give them an opportunity to get rid of this person they despise so much. So that's the base. You've already got the base. But I don't think this is going to play well with the moderates, independents, swing voters. Again, you know, prognostication is not... It's not a secure way to make a living when it comes to politics, I don't think. So that's just my opinion. But I just don't see it. Where was the groundswell? Where were the how many people in bars and restaurants and over the last? Because this is really only since July, right? I mean, yeah. We have only known about it since what? October or November, the phone call was made in July.
Yeah, it came on real quick there in the fall.
So where's this groundswell come from? Even with this thing where they didn't vote last night and got together for 15 minutes today so they get more coverage of it, they're still looking. They're using impeachment as a thing. They're hoping it's a snowball that will roll down the hill and get bigger and bigger and bigger. And usually... you're going to be more successful. First of all, no president has ever been removed through the impeachment process in this country. So the odds are long, and we know this time it won't happen. But in the reason, I think, is because, like, Nixon resigned because he felt like he was going to be removed from office, and he just left before it happened. There was a groundswell involved there. There were voices and media and people trying to convince you, but at the basic gut level, the president's people breaking into the opposition's headquarters was just a real easy thing to go, the president shouldn't be covering up for something like that. And there was a groundswell. If you want to remove a president in the future, I think you have to be responding to the people. Now, you can gin them up through media and spectacle, but you genuinely, by the time you get to the point where you're voting on this stuff, you need to be able to say, hey, people want this. I don't see, outside of the people who were, you know, wearing the foofy hats, within days of him being inaugurated, I don't see outside of that crowd the call for this to happen. I could be wrong, but yeah.
Even now, I'm looking at Twitter trends, which, I mean, this news came down, I guess, about 20 minutes ago. Usually, if it's huge,
it should be the top trend.
Goes immediately to the top, but you still have Friday the 13th as the top trend, followed by Friday Feeling, Friday Thoughts, and then...
Really?
And then Moscow, Mitch McConnell, and it doesn't, you go all the way down.
Moscow Mitch is above impeachment and Twitter trends.
The House Judiciary Committee is the 11th highest trend on there. So it still is not even jumping up there at all.
That'd be interesting to look at that. I got to figure it's got to get to number one at some point.
Got it. I'm keeping an eye on it.
I don't know, Friday Feeling, baby.
No, Friday Feeling is tough. Trump the other night called it.
This is impeachment light.
Impeachment light. It really doesn't, it's not landing. It's landing with a dull, not even a thud, so which is bizarre. It was bizarre. Even with Clinton, people were arguing about it. And most people thought that he shouldn't be impeached. That's why he wasn't removed. I mean, you ran into a different situation. Republicans had the House, Democrats had the Senate. But yeah, I think it's political suicide. I'll be interested to see if I'm right or I'm wrong. And a lot of things can happen between now and November that can affect people's vote. But when you put in what happened in England, you know, this was the same. This is a good analog. A good analog. Have we not been told, since Brexit was voted on, which Brexit was seen as the Trumpism of England, and we've been told, oh, people were shocked. A lot of people didn't go out and vote. You know, they should have it again. We should have another. We should have another vote on it because it's not really the will of the people. Well, lo and behold, Boris Johnson calls a snap election, and he has more power than any prime minister has had since Margaret Thatcher in the early 80s, and his opposition, Labour, who, by the way, were pushing a lot of the same socialism that the Democrat nominees are pushing, have the least amount of power they've had in Parliament since the 1930s. I don't know if these Democrats are just dumb, but there's a feeling in this world, in the Western world right now. Yes, we love our democracy, we love republics, we love all of that, but this permanent class of diplomats and bureaucrats, people are not happy with. And what's the remainers in Europe are a lot of the same types that are the impeachment types here. And they are either from that class of diplomats and bureaucrats, or they're heavily influenced by that class, the elite. We're smart. We're not boobs like those farmers in Iowa. I mean, we went to college. We understand these things. You felt that here about the Trumpers, and it's exactly the same argument about the people who voted to leave Europe. Oh, those are the dumb people. You can't find smart people at Cambridge, you believe that. Well, there's not enough smart people at Cambridge to sway the vote. If you want to win elections, you have to go out and persuade people to your point of view. And calling them stupid for disagreeing with you probably isn't the best opening line, which is exactly what's happening. And they're going down like dominoes. You know, these diplomats, they've done some very good work over the years, but they got a little bit lost. All of this, the diplomatic corps response to how Trump deals with Kim Jong-un, for instance, and who knows how that's going. I mean, whether it's good or bad. I think most people are thinking, yeah, but you guys have been taking care of this for the last 30 years, and we're where we are. People aren't saying, I think Trump, I mean, you've got we all know there's the Trumpers who, you know, they think he walks on water, but that's not most people. It's not even most of the support. He's an alternative to status quo. And I don't use the term deep state. I don't. There's a permanent class. There has to be. In any republic where you're electing new governments all the time, you can't send everybody home and start at the DMV and start staffing people every time there's a new government. So there are people who are there, and most of them are good people, but there's powerful people, and any powerful people will abuse that power or just take things in a direction that the average person doesn't think. The average person doesn't wake up in the morning thinking about how they live in a criminal nation that is somehow the worst thing that ever happened to the world. I say this all the time about, because I know a lot of people, comedians and artists who travel to Europe and come back and forth, and a lot of the same kind of like highfalutin, why are people so stupid? And it's very simple to me. Why does the average person in England want to leave Europe? I would say a lot of it has to do with being told what they want to buy a tea kettle. In Brussels, they decide what the standards for tea kettles are, and you can't buy that old tea kettle you've been buying your whole life because for purposes of climate change or whatever. Now, this is the new standard, and people find that they don't like it. It's like the dishwashers here. We have a real problem with dishwashers in this country. Are you aware of this?
No.
There's a real problem with them. Have you noticed it takes a long time to really clean your dishes in a dishwasher? You think back to the 70s or 80s. This is all about water control. And so the dishwashers that we've had for the last 15 years or so, 20 years, have had these energy regulations on them so that we don't waste water. The problem is they don't clean your dishes very well. So what happens is people wash them twice and use more water than they would the first time around if they hadn't made the changes. But here's the thing. When you have bureaucrats, part of the bureaucracy are the rules makers. That's their job. They make rules. My job is to come in 5 days a week and create a three-hour radio show. So what do? Every day, we come in and we do a radio show. Well, if your job is to make rules and you go to work, what do? You make rules because that's your job security. And eventually, you start making ridiculous rules about dishwashers in America and tea kettles in England. And it's and then the academics are like, no, it's xenophobia and it's racism. And it's no, it look, there are idiots. There are idiots and they vote and they're around all the time. But the reporting is so. Do you have the audio of Trump in the Happy Hanukkah moment? Play number 11. I just, because we're told by this group that I'm talking about of academics and the smart people that this Trump, he's a white nationalist. He's a white nationalist. He's a fascist. Okay, play cut 11.
If you want to accept the tremendous amount. Melania and I are delighted to welcome so many friends and families to this incredible house, the White House, to celebrate this really sacred season and a very special time. To everyone here today, Happy Hanukkah.
Now, here's my challenge to any reporter. Find the other white nationalist in the history of the world who stands in front of a room, invites a room full of Jewish people into whatever their government offices are, and say, I'm very proud to be here on such a sacred religious holiday, Hanukkah. That's my challenge. Find for me the other white nationalist in history that has done that.
The Von Haessler Doctrine.
They have such a beautiful chemistry.
Making listeners laugh every day.
The world could use a little more of that these days.
9 to noon on 95.5 WSB. Atlantis News and Talk.
So you have another story for me? I think I've rattled on enough about...
Did you not like my connection?
The disconnect between the elite, the so-called elite, and here and in England, and having to do with Trump and having to do with Boris Johnson.
Well, I think your whole point is void because everything happened because it's Friday the 13th.
Is that the idea?
The impeachment vote and Boris Johnson
Friday
getting elected.
But that wouldn't make any sense because the same type of person would be in favor of one and against the other. So you can't blame Friday the 13th. So your little attempt at humor was a fail.
Failure.
Total fail.
Friday the 13th plays in many 13th, ways.
I don't know... I think that I don't believe in these numbers and being afraid of numbers, as I've said, but it will be fitting if this ends up losing the House. I don't know if it can lose the House. I don't know how vulnerable. I know that there's 31 Democrats who were elected in districts that were won big by Trump in 16, but then Trump wasn't on the ballot in 18 and it went back Democrats. This time Trump's in all of those districts, Trump's going to be back on the ballot in 2020. And I would say that a lot of those people probably aren't very safe. Whether that would be enough, whether that would be the beginning of a snowball that would turn the House around, I don't know.
There's one thing that a lot of people aren't definitely not talking about yet, but I know about this because I'm always looking into it. There are going to be record numbers of minority candidates running for Republican House seats.
Now, does that work or does it not work?
We'll find out.
Because the thing is, and I think that Democrats need to realize this, there are good candidates... which is somebody who goes out there and engages the public and is likable. And then there are bad candidates. And I don't think that it matters that you're a man or a woman or that you're black or white or Asian or Native American. You can be, you could check all the boxes for the Democrats, inclusion and all of that, and just not be a very good candidate. I mean, look what happened in England. Boris Johnson did the same thing that Theresa May did. And she lost seats. This is basically the same thing. When you talk about candidates, this was the same thing. She couldn't get Brexit, her deal, through. So she called a snap election so she could get more power in Parliament so she could get it through. And she lost seats. Now, Boris Johnson comes along, does basically exactly the same thing. He's a great candidate. He engages with people. He knows how to deal. He knows how to get people on his side. And he walks out with the biggest majority the Tories have had since the early 80s. Candidates matter. It doesn't matter whether they wear pants or a dress. It matters whether or not they can actually engage with the public. Hour three of the Von Haessler Doctrine begins right now. Clark's Christmas Kids continues today. Clark and I will be at the Walmart on Windward Parkway in Alpharetta. And Smiling Mark and Scott Slade will be at the Walmart in Buford, Sardis Church Road in Buford. The broadcast will begin 3 to 7. Donations, you can show up starting at 2. Get a list for of a foster kid, what they want for Christmas. Go ahead and buy those gifts and then drop them off. We'll make sure that they have something under their tree, have exactly the gifts that they requested that you bought for them under their tree. You can start that at 2. We will show up at 3 and be there from 3 to 7. I'll be there from 3 to 5. Of course, Clark is always there. Once he starts, he's always there. Jared Yamamoto is going to show up about 5 o'clock at the Windward Parkway location.
Be ready. Hugs and all.
Are you going to be hugging people?
I think,
ask for a hug.
Tis the season.
Flu season, man. Tis the season for flu.
It is a weird thing. I guess the flu is smart because it comes around when we start being most social with all of our parties, mm-hmm. office parties. Mm-hmm. Starts with Thanksgiving, getting together with a wider extended family.
Joe says it's because we eat meat on the holidays.
Well, Dr. Joe is entitled to his own opinion. I was watching something else earlier. The attack on the kosher deli in Jersey City a couple days ago. And by the way, I pointed out that the guys who did that belonged to the same group, incidentally, that was the group that was yelling at the 16-year-old with the MAGA hat with the Indian drummer guy in front of him. That I don't hear anybody else mentioning that, but that happens to be a truth. And didn't you tell me that Rashida Tlaib?
Rashida Tlaib, the congresswoman from Minnesota.
Yeah. As soon as the Jersey City thing happened, she tweeted what?
White supremacy.
Yeah, white supremacy kills or something like that. And then we found out it was the, whatever these black Israelite weird group.
They stand around New York City and yell at people.
If they have 40 members, I would imagine I would imagine they don't have that many. And so what, she deleted it because that was her first thing was, oh, it has to be a white. Oh, and it turns out the world's a little more complicated than that. But I was watching earlier and, after something like this, you get all the community people and everybody's given speeches about hate and what do we do about hate. There have always been hateful people. I guess that there always will be hateful people. I don't know that you can have government programs that get rid of hate. But if you want to teach people not to hate, if that's the idea, is get to kids early and teach them not to hate, here's the thing. It needs to be universal. You can't tell kids that it's wrong to hate certain aggrieved groups, but it's okay to hate the cops and people in the top 1%. It's a mixed message. If you want to get in there with children who are 4 or 5 years, it has to be universal. You shouldn't be hating anyone who, simply because of who they are. If they beat you up on the playground, well, that's a guy you go, hey, I don't like that guy. If there's some sort of action that takes place that makes you dislike someone. But if the message is about hate and what to do about hate, you can't on one hand from the left say, oh, hate is bad, and then show up with bullhorns yelling hateful messages at people that you don't like. It's a mixed message, yeah.
That fits with the smirking kid who was 16 and Greta Thunberg, who is 16.
Yeah.
If you are caught criticizing Greta Thunberg, then you are a hypocrite.
You're horrible. You're horrible.
But yet the smirking kid who was wearing the MAGA hat.
Yeah, you had to be right on top of that. Yeah, we know what he's all about, but that's not perceived as prejudice, when of course it is. It's right there in the word. You're prejudging someone based on the hat that's on their head and a smirk, I guess, which I don't even know that he knew he was smirking.
He didn't. He was standing there smiling, trying not to lose it.
Trying not to have a thing happen to him because he was probably scared as hell. These people across the street that are yelling at him, who now we know a couple of their members were the ones who went and shot up the kosher deli. You see, young reporters, if you get away from the narrative and you're a curious person, that the world is still very complicated and interesting and full of stories. But if you're just going to be the 750th person to cover what everyone else is covering in the narrative that everyone else has put out there, then you're basically, in journalistic terms, worthless. Worthless. Oh, I'm not going to look into what this group is that was yelling at the kid. The story is the kid. He was wearing a MAGA hat and he was smirking. How did that help your career, being the 732nd person who got on that story? However, look what we have here. Maybe an expose of that group may have shown a light on that group before the Jersey City thing happened. The world is complicated. This is something that diehards on both sides will not allow, because to them, the world is black and white and one or the other, and just make a choice, or I don't respect the fact that you can't make a choice. Which is fine for people, but it's really sad that the journalism has gone this way, or what's left of journalism. No curiosity. Just want to be the next voice saying the thing that most other voices are saying. It's boring. That's why the ratings are horrible. I mean, even Fox News is so predictable. Why the hell would I turn it on? What, am I going to learn something new? I know what Sean Hannity's going to think about today. I know what everybody at Fox, I know what Laura Ingram's, I know what Tucker Carlson's going to, well, I'm just going to sit on my ass and listen to them say what I knew they were going to say before. Give me a story. Give me something interesting. Give me a twist. Let me know something I didn't know about. Otherwise, I'm trying to lose weight anyway, so I'm trying to find reasons not to sit on the couch. I'm not even watching sports stuff.
Oh, but you could take your 24-hour news on the go on your phone.
Which I do with WSB Radio.
Oh, yes. That's right.
I got it plugged into my bloodstream.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, smart. It's like an IV drip. Just goes right in. It's like I get updates constantly.
You know, Eric, when I was in college as a broadcasting major, I took a bunch of journalism classes, news reporting, and for TV and for the newspaper. And anything that I even had a whiff of personal thought or ideology, it was snuffed out by the professors. They said, take that out of there or no one's ever going
to
hire you.
No one's ever going to. It used to be that way. Now, we know that everybody does have a point of view, right?
Right.
So no one can actually be completely and totally 100% neutral, but as a reporter, you should make the effort. You should be able to understand your own biases and do what you can to make sure that you limit them. If the idea of reporting, which to me the idea of reporting is, people are busy. They got jobs, they got families, so they can't be watching City Hall all the time. So my beat is to go watch City Hall all the time and come back with reports to let them know what's going on at City Hall. Now, as a human being, I obviously am going to have an opinion on what's happening at City Hall, but as a good reporter, I'm going to recognize what those opinions are and try to push them down. And that doesn't mean you don't throw in context or personal style of writing and all of that. But that should be the idea of a reporter. A good reporter, I've said this so many times, and I think there used to be more of this. I mean, let's not, there were no great old days. The press was always liberal. I mean, before Fox News, no one even knew there was any such thing as a black conservative. Yeah. Tony Brown's Journal on PBS on Sunday nights at 7 or something was like, wow, that guy's a black guy, he's conservative.
And Clarence Thomas, that's it.
Well, Clarence Thomas you knew just because of what happened.
Right.
But, it was always liberal, but there was an effort was made to understand that the audience was made up of people more than people who just voted just like you. And this morning, again, it might be the small things, and I'm not trying to turn a molehill into a mountain, but in the little things, you can see the big things. And the fact that CNN didn't cover the Republican press conference by the congressional people who are in that committee minutes after they voted these articles of impeachment out of committee and just had pundits talking instead, that's so telling. Their job, they have 24 hours to give you the news, and they made a decision that wasn't worth covering. I would love to forensics just be sitting with somebody in a CNN newsroom and say, what was the thought process that said that's not news? Yeah.
Now, I watch a lot of CNN in the morning when I'm waking up, getting ready, having my coffee and whatnot. And one of the things that's been it's been said a lot over the last 2 weeks has been that Democrats deal in facts and Republicans do not deal in facts. So whether it was
the IG report or the
impeachment, and the whole panel would agree, and they're like,
And meanwhile, what we found out was that the IG report was a condemnation of what's going on in the FBI. Basically, he said they didn't break any laws and they didn't break protocol, and that's a problem because the standards are way too low to open up a case like this. And that's all that the media focused on. Once the thing got going, there was plenty of criticism in that report of how that system was done and what the people did around it. But again, and saying that one side deals in facts and the other one deals in, that's an opinion. That in and of itself is not a fact. That's an opinion. Because I could say, well, the way you covered the IG report was not based on facts because Horowitz ran out of there really with his hair on fire. He's a diplomat and he didn't act like that. But basically, that was a warning to the country about what's going on with these secret courts. But it wasn't covered that way because the opinion was the important thing is that our guys were exonerated. That's not news. That's not reporting.
But if everybody on the panel agrees, Eric, what am I supposed to think as the viewer?
Well, here's the thing. You look at the fact that Trump got elected and that Boris Johnson just got an overwhelming. I don't think those panels have the influence they think they do. The people that are tuned in, and I say this about Fox News too. I don't watch Fox News hardly ever. It's the same thing. I'm not interested in just a pep rally, you know, of people who are going to agree with some of the things. There's a lot of things I don't agree with, but on fiscal issues and things like that, taxation. Don't be boring. I'm talking to people right now. Don't be boring. Don't listen. Don't just watch shows that are just going to, they know what you want to hear and they just vomit it up back at you. Life is short. Be curious. Know who you are. Be fair. And go out and have a good time. Stop watching all these pundit panels. It's not helping your life, I can tell you that. You got an open mic, I hear?
Yes, yeah. Back in the 9 o'clock hour, we talked, before all the impeachment stuff came down, we talked about Taylor Swift.
And she's the woman of the decade for Billboard, and she got up there and did nothing but complain about the fact that the patriarchal system is holding her down.
Pretty much. Yeah. This open micer wanted to weigh in about that.
If Taylor Swift is upset about how copyright laws are structured and that other people can buy music she made, then it seems to me she should be going to her local congressperson and not complaining about the guy that bought the music. Change the laws. Don't go after the people who take advantage of them.
That's a great point. Also, to couch it all in language, first of all, if you want to be a feminist speaker and you want to be effective, don't just throw out buzzwords we've heard before. Toxic male privilege. Once I hear that, I know you're just saying something you've heard somebody else say. You're not interesting until you say something I haven't heard before. Put it in your own words. And, you know, what is she? She's 30 years old, worth $360 million. By the way, the same thing she's complaining about happened to Paul McCartney. And although as he ages, he may look a little bit like a woman, he's not a woman. He wanted to buy the Beatles catalog. Michael Jackson kept outbidding him. I think it's a D-bag move. If I was bidding for that and somebody who wrote the songs was bidding, I'd back out. But it didn't happen to her because she's a woman, because it happened to Paul McCartney in the 80s. There's Paul McCartney. He wanted to own that. But Michael Jackson outbid him. A D-bag move. But it wasn't because of sexism. I mean, if anything, Paul McCartney certainly was not the feminine member of that sparring group. But ostensibly, it's two men. I mean, it's my point. With Taylor Swift last night, she got Entertainer of the Decade, Woman of the Decade.
Woman of the Decade.
All right, well, she probably deserves it. But she gets up there in her speech and starts going off because it's the white patriarchal, toxic masculinity is keeping her from owning her own songs.
And let me just say that the definition of the toxic male privilege in our industry is people saying, but he's always been nice to me when I'm raising valid concerns about artists and their rights to own their music.
And of course he's nice to you. If you're in this room, you have something he needs.
What are you, discovering something? The record company screw artist? Wow, this is new. Is this because you're wearing a dress from time to time? Anything, you know?
Wasn't done, Eric.
The fact is that private equity is what enabled this man to think, according to his own social media post,
Peter Braun,
that he could buy me. But I'm obviously not going willingly. Yet the most amazing thing was to discover that it would be the women in our industry who would have my back and show me the most vocal support at one of the most difficult times. And I will never, ever forget it. Like, ever.
Like ever.
Well,
yeah. That's like, hey, if you want to be a big speaker on big issues, ending on...
Like, ever.
Probably isn't going to get you in the Hall of Fame.
I wish Prince were still alive. I feel like he would be able to say something here.
Yeah, well, she's crazy.
He wouldn't even...
He had similar issues.
And the point is, it's not because she's a woman.
Right.
Because record companies have been screwing musicians over forever. That doesn't make it right or wrong, but it's not a sexism issue. And, you know, I didn't watch that, obviously. I wouldn't be caught dead watching something like that. But,
Like ever.
But it doesn't sound like the speech is going over all that well, right? She's not getting much response. You know, you're supposed to be happy. We named you Decade. Look, she's very talented, but she's 30 and she's worth almost $400 million. It seems to me that this system, patriarchal or not, seems to have worked out fine for her.
You know,
there's plenty of people that have not been treated, have not had the success that she had. And what I would say to her is that in every life, a little rain must fall. You're not a victim. You know, you wonder how so many people choose victimhood. But if we really actually say, yes, Taylor Swift, you're wildly talented, you're 30, you're worth $360 million, and we say, oh yeah, no, you're a victim. Well, if she's a victim, well, why wouldn't somebody who's having trouble making rent? Well, it makes it the easiest option, and it's the worst thing you can do. Especially if you're young and things aren't working out for you, the worst thing you can do is see yourself as a victim. You've got to fight. You've got to figure out a way to fight and how to do it. But if Taylor Swift is a victim with her $360 million in 30 years of life, and we all say, yeah, she's a victim, then how could we ever say to somebody who's having trouble making rent, you know, whose boyfriend took off after the kid was born, and what? How could we say that you're not? But here's the thing. It doesn't help you to see yourself as a victim. It helps you as just seeing the world the way that it is, and trying to figure out a way to use the world's natural energy in your favor. Try to plug in somewhere.
She feels like she's not seeing herself as a victim because she's fighting for what she believes in with copyright law or whatever she's doing. But her assigning the reason why she's in this position because she's a woman and that person is a man is inherently making her a victim.
It's making her a victim, and it's not correct.
A victim of her own gender.
It's not correct. Little Richard went to his grave telling everybody how much he got screwed by the record companies. This has been going on forever. And since, because of the patriarchal system, there are a lot more successful male musical artists than... In numbers only, just straight up numbers, more guys have been screwed by the record industry than women just because.
Ask Tommy James.
Oh, ask them all.
Anyway, they got those mob guys.
Ask everybody. Yeah. I mean, Kevin Kitty tells me all these stories about when you're, you know, one time he was taken to lunch, the album after Fly Me Courageous. He was taken to dinner, big steakhouse, big dinner, you know, record executives. They were going to talk about what the single from the record should be. They wanted it to be Turn It Up or Turn It Off. He wasn't in favor of it. Then he told me by the end of it, he realized, oh, this isn't, you're not asking me. You're telling me. Yeah. But the part about this over is when it was all over, you get an invoice. He found out he paid for the meal.
No.
Yes.
Wow.
That's how it's done. They get people in. You need them. Now, you know, I'd be interested to find out if Billie Eilish is going to have to deal with this. Because, right, her brother understood how to make music on his own. And by the time the record companies got involved, it was really probably about distribution and tours and things like that. I'd be interested to see if if someone like Billie Eilish has signed a horrible contract like this, but back then, or even when Taylor Swift came along, you needed these big record companies to get your name out there, to push your song. Her song didn't just, there weren't country DJs who were just like, hey, no, that stuff got in front of them, it was put in front of them, and you need them, and that's why you sign these egregious things. But it's happened to an awful lot of people. And by the way, you think, that's another thing I learned from Kevin, you think that... you're going to have a video and you're going to have studio time. And you think all of this is being picked up? No. Then they give you an invoice. So you were signed at a certain number. And then by the time it comes time to pay you, you find out, no, I paid for the music video. I paid for all the studio time.
That's why everybody has to tour so that they can make the real money from touring.
Exactly. Yep.
Well, and I think a lot of artists, too, have kind of gotten on to the Lil Wayne track where obviously Lil Wayne was popular in the early 2000s and he still is relevant now. But, I mean, he created Young Money. His own label, where he controlled all of the distribution costs.
But you got to look deep into that, though. Usually when an artist creates their own label, they're still hooked up to a bigger label for distribution because it's very difficult. Distribution is a hard thing. It's not as hard as it used to be. You used to have to get your records in every record store in America. You needed help doing that. You couldn't drive your records around. Record stores is not where people go to buy music anymore. So all you got to do now is you got to hire, you know, a small boutique shop that gets your stuff on Spotify and iTunes and everywhere it needs to be.
Mixcloud.
And then you, whatever it is. So my problem with her is, she should be talking about artists being screwed by record companies, which has been happening since the beginning of record companies and artists. But to put it into some phony baloney sexist language is just trying to be relevant in a way just... I don't know. I guess she feels it'll help her career to be a feminist spokesperson. She's not a very good one.
Like, ever.
Here at the end of the show, I want to take some time. We here have lost a friend and a colleague, and it's a very difficult day here. You may not hear it on the air, but behind the scenes, it's a very difficult day because we've lost one of our own. Reporter Pete Combs succumbed to cancer yesterday. And he'd been in hospice for about a week, and we all knew that it was coming, but it hit like a ton of bricks. I brought in Chris Camp so that we can talk about Pete a little bit, but before we get to that, Chris Chandler put together a package. If you can go ahead and play that first.
Pete died after a brutal but mercifully brief bout with cancer. You know, there aren't that many shoe leather bags or packs send me anywhere live on the spot radio reporters anymore, and he was one of the best. He covered elections. Hostage crisis.
We just heard a major explosion here. More gunshots now.
Snowmageddon.
Several school buses stuck in bad road conditions.
And lots and lots of hurricanes.
Very hard to see more than a couple of hundred yards away. What I can see is the building with the roof now shearing off.
He was so disturbed by what he'd seen at Hurricane Michael that long after the national media had packed up and left, he went back to the panhandle at Christmas to follow up. His documentary won an award. And you may not realize that as he reported for us, Pete was also a full-time correspondent for ABC Radio, CBS before that. He was not only an enthusiast, but an aviation expert, owned a podcast company to pursue that interest. Fittingly, the last story Pete covered for us was Hurricane Dorian. He was 60 years old.
Pete Combs, WSB.
I have Chris Camp here, our news director. I wanted to bring you in.
You know, it's true. You know these things are coming, and we knew, you know, Pete's days were numbered. But it's still a gut punch when it happens, and you get the phone call or the text message or whatever. Doesn't matter.
Yeah.
It still takes you, and it's a blow to the head for sure.
Pete was here, and then he was gone, and then he came back.
Mm-hmm.
And in the middle part there is when I started to get a weekend show, and then we were on for an hour, and then 2 hours, then 3 hours. And by the time Pete came back, I probably had only two or three long conversations with him.
Mm-hmm.
But man, was he a good person. And told me this has nothing to do with it, but he liked the show and said, you know, I would like to be involved if you ever need reporters or be involved. And I said, absolutely. And kind of as we were starting to figure out how to do that is when the diagnosis came down.
Yeah, and you know, there were certainly many attributes that Pete had. Among them was the fact that he knew a little bit about a lot. You know, it was like, you know, a good reporter basically has like a shoebox of knowledge in their head. You know, they can, you know, they can talk about, maybe not go in depth with a lot of stuff, but they can talk with specificity about a lot of different things. And that was, you know, just one of the many things that he brought to the table.
Well, he had that kind of curiosity that leads him to, you know, and it's another thing that, you know, radio is obviously an audio medium. See, it's hard to believe now when everybody's doing stuff on Instagram at the same time and Facebook, and we do all these things. But it's an audio medium, which makes it very different. And when you hear Pete Combs, obviously, you know, this is the first station I've ever worked at that I actually listened to. So I used to listen to WSB when I worked at other stations. Yeah. And so I listened to Pete an awful lot when he was here the first time around. And when you hear a voice like that, it's born to be on the radio.
It's, it is. And it's also, I mean, the way he was able to describe things. I mean, you listen to his hurricane coverage. It was really, you know, just, I mean, his storytelling. I mean, when he was in Haiti, for the earthquake down there and the long form programming that he sent back after that. And even the Chris Chandler mentioned in that piece when Hurricane Michael came ashore on the Florida Panhandle and there were all sorts of problems in South Georgia and he went back down there. I remember vividly being on the phone with him and we were talking about, you know, what should we put together and, you know, how we should, you know, produce it and so forth. And we were talking about what he was seeing, and he was just amazed that it was Christmas time or coming up to Christmas. And there were just, you know, instead of Christmas ornaments and lights up and everything, there were just blue tarps on roofs, as you see everywhere. And that's how, you know, Blue Tarp Christmas and that documentary was put together, and he won an award with it. It was just, it was marvelous material.
It's something in a wider, I don't know, because of the way things are, I don't know that we're going to get as many radio reporters as, you know, he's from a class of reporter that we used to, every few years we get somebody like that. And I don't know how many Pete Combs we're going to get in the future, given the way the industry is now. A lot of people wonder, well, you've got Channel 2. Why, how come we have radio reporters when there's TV reporters who go and do, why don't we just get reports? But you have to understand about this medium is there's a difference there. And nothing against TV reporters. They're very good at what they do. But you can see what's happening behind them. A radio reporter has to paint the picture. And Pete Combs was of that group of radio reporters that knew how to do that and bring you to the place that you couldn't physically actually see.
Well, and go in depth on, too, as you pointed out. I mean, you know, having Pete come on the show and be able to talk more definitively about things. I mean, you can get a story in 30 seconds, you can get a story in a minute 15, but enable to, you know, the ability to go beyond that and bring a story back, to bring the emotion back, and to be able to be a storyteller is really an art. It's an art form.
Well, I'll tell you, from my point of view, I was only able to have a couple of really good long conversations with him. Very nice person. I always enjoyed his reporting. And, you know, it just saddens me that this was somebody who we were working on. He was going to be our go-to expert, the guy in the field.
Absolutely.
And for this to have happened, I just wanted to take this time. Chris Camp, thanks for coming in. And to Pete's surviving family, WSB is part of your family, and we're hurting. And we'll continue to hurt. Only time heals these kind of wounds.
Just remember, we're all the better for knowing him.
Absolutely. And I only knew him briefly, and I'm better for it. Thank you, Chris Camp. This show was dedicated to the memory of the great Pete Combs, and we wish his family the best. We're going to go over and do the podcast 30 now. You can join us by going to the Von Haessler Doctrine Facebook page or the WSB Radio Facebook page. Click on the red box. You can watch us do the podcast 30. We'll be back on Monday. You're all invited to join us. But until then, we're thinking about you, Pete, and we're thinking about Pete's family.
Pete Combs, WSB.
Rest in peace. Thanks for listening to the Von Haessler Doctrine podcast. Remember, you can hear the show every weekday from 9 to noon right here on 95.5 WSB, Atlanta's news and talk.
What you talking about?
Podcast 30.
Take all that.
That's what I'm talking about. The podcast 30. What are you talking about?
This is Different Strokes, right?
This is Chris Lake, Deceiver. Oh,
he doesn't even know the reference. You don't even know the What You Talking About reference. You don't even know.
I don't.
It's Different Strokes.
What You Talking About, Willis?
Gary Coleman.
Oh, yeah.
And What You Talking About? Come on.
What You Talking About, Willis?
Well, that show was off the air before he was born. That's hard to believe, but he wasn't born until 1989.
Yeah.
J-Rad. J-Rad on the tunes.
E&T Swift.
And Autumn Fisher is with us. You know what? 1989, there was a realization that I came to the other day. It's leaving me now, so if it comes back to me, I'll tell you about it. That's the way my brain works. I just accept it. Yeah, there's the intern, not intern. She's the promotion.
Oh, yeah.
Sorry, it's not an intern.
Yeah. She works for promotion. She came up from the bad guys, came to the good guys.
Is it Soulmate?
I think it's Soulmate.
Soulmate, yeah. Well, every time I see her, I forget her name.
And then you get nervous?
No, and I just walked through the hall, and it took me just like it did there. I was like, starts with an S, but I got it right. I got it right, and I explained to her that I just have to accept it. There's a lot of stuff goes on in my brain. There's a lot of bing, bang, boom, boom, boom. But retention is not part of it. And so I just have to keep moving. That's why we improvise everything.
Oh, that's
just
dope.
Just be in the moment.
Dope.
What, are you calling me a dope, or are you blaming it on the dope?
I don't think you're a dope. You're a smart guy, but it's dope.
Gosh, you're saying that I've smoked too much pot in my life.
Too much weed.
Well, you know, I'm doing all
too
right.
Too much CBD.
I don't know. I don't do that, and I also have trouble with names. I'll know the person's name, but I'm afraid to say it in case it's wrong, and then I get into like an endless loop.
That's what happens to me. That's what happens to me. Quite often, I will get jammed up in my brain, whether it's names or something else, where I think I've said something wrong, and then my brain just keeps going back, but I didn't say something wrong. I got it right, but I end up backtracking so much, and then I don't know where the hell I am.
Your brain trips you up.
So I just decide to improvise my way through life, and live in the moment, and I don't have to worry about it. It's like, I'm like the guy in Memento.
Women have it a little bit easier in that case, though, because they can be like, oh, girl, like that.
I can do that.
Hey, girl.
What I used to do, the trick that I used to do, which I need to bring back, but once I tell everybody, they know it's a trick, is if I lose my train of thought, then I can just go, you know, with the FCC, I better not say that. And then move on to something else. That's a good one. That's a good one.
I think
English Nick is with us.
We all second guess things we say on the radio sometimes.
Oh, I go home
even
every day.
I'm like, shall I go with this idea or not?
Yeah. I feel bad about something that I've done on the show every day.
Really?
Why?
Yeah. I mean, I don't know. It just lasts a little while. It doesn't drive me crazy.
Like how you've treated me, probably.
How I've treated Autumn or not telling Autumn something.
But you always text me and say, maybe you weren't harsh enough.
Yeah, I know. Well,
wait a minute.
As a coach, you have to know how to motivate your different players with different things. So I go to Autumn and I say, you know what? I don't show my appreciation for you enough. And that motivates her. That motivates her. And then I go to Tim and I'll say something like, yeah, that Autumn, she's really getting under my nerves.
He
goes, yeah, me too. And I get... Ultimately, all that matters is that by 9 a.m., everybody's ready to go.
Yeah, that's true. No matter how they're motivated. Yeah,
Jared should feel bad for what he just said about women having it easier. They don't have it easier, Jared. We know this now.
Yes.
Taylor Swift has put that out.
She's an aggrieved victim with $360 million in her pocket.
She's got a
big overhead.
Yeah, she does. A forehead, big forehead.
Yeah, she does.
I don't know. I've never heard a Taylor Swift song from beginning to end.
Really?
Really?
Shake It Off's a great song.
I've heard Shake It Off. I think Shake It Off. Oh, no, that's not true. I've heard all of that album, but it was the version
of
Ryan Adams.
Ryan Adams.
Yeah.
It's so good.
Yeah,
not to be confused with Bryan Adams.
No. That's the most I know of Taylor Swift is I know every song off that Shake It Off album because he did that album. Like, he covered it.
Was it 1989?
Yeah.
I did a metal version of that once for Songs for Kids.
Shake It Off?
Yeah.
It seems like one of those songs that can go in any style.
You can take it anywhere, yeah.
It's like S-A-T-U-R-D-A-Y Night. You could do that as a country song, a pop song. It's an easy punk song.
Mm. I had a boyfriend that did Last Train to Clarksville as a bluegrass song. It was really good.
Yeah, you see? It's going
to
happen.
Take the last train to Clarksville, and I'll meet you all
soon. Is he famous now? Is he in Nashville?
Nope.
Is that when you broke up with him, when he decided to do that cover?
Be there by 4:30 on the go.
He was big into music.
It was good.
I remember that guy.
He had he was able to have a bad finger discussion with me. I mean, not many
nice,
people can
he
do
was
that.
A nice guy, I thought.
Yeah.
She screwed nice him guy. Over, I think.
Screwed him all over.
She didn't want it. She didn't come and get it.
That's right. She didn't want it. She didn't come and get it. And that's
she made her mind up fast.
That's a Paul McCartney song anyway.
Yeah, I know. Sounds it, too. It.
Well, I mean, if you look at
want,
it's on,
that part.
It's on the new, I think it's on the extras from the new Abbey Road
thing. Oh, him singing it?
Yeah, but it was on Anthology before.
He Sonny.
went in there and did all, he plays the drums, does all the, and I does the singing, that. And there's nothing about their version that is any different from that demo. It is exactly that, except there's
more
orchestration.
Listen, if Paul McCartney gives you a piece of music, are you going to change it? Like, well, I got this,
come
Paul.
On, baby, now. Don't change my song. Come on, baby, now.
Yeah.
All right. We Macca. Have to do another segment for...
All right. So now what we're picking up, just so that way you know what we talked about, because this is all one show that's only going to air one time.
Yeah.
We talked about the words of the decade, right. And we talked about the star-crossed lovers, and that was the last thing that happened. Now
what was the star? You star, and me.
It was about yes. someone's
you,
butt.
You, no, you and you, yeah. Star?
Yeah, we're fam, and yeah. we're talking about Bay, and well, yeah. okay. I can't
Teen
remember.
Teen is Eric Sin. That's yeah. basically
that's
right. it.
But, and so but now, we're but, coming into a new half hour, so we don't have to talk about that.
You don't necessarily have to talk about right. it, but if you wanted to, that's right. what we've that's where we've been.
Quick question. If Teen is out and Eric Sin, will he have to be on the Power Pod every Wednesday?
Probably. Yes. As I'm also identifying as a millennial. Now,
you have to start wearing Spanx.
You have to change that
Hey,
segment.
They're coming back. Spring 2020, Manx.
Hey,
coming
that,
back.
That would look good, huh?
Yeah,
that's what I need to walk around in.
Hey, though, the creator and the owner was in today's New York Times crossword puzzle.
Oh, really? His, yeah. The boss, Christina's boss?
Spanx, yep.
Well, so she was on the Regular Guys once.
She is fun. I'll give it to her. She's tenacious. She's
I'll
actually,
give it to her.
I'll give it
you
to her.
You know what?
I mean,
give
most
it to
women
her.
Are not fun, but I got to
no,
give it to
but,
her.
No, but this one, surprisingly fun.
I'm just saying, sometimes, you know how when you meet...
You know, a boss can
when
be
you meet a boss stern. Or a CEO, they can yeah. be they can give you the small talk, right? Yeah. And you're like, okay, like yeah. clearly you don't want to have a real conversation with
Where
me.
Where did you go to school, young man?
Yeah, exactly. That kind of talk.
Yeah, I don't see her saying that.
Sarah Blakely is not that kind of person. She's a person that gets real with you and can have a real conversation with you. And I appreciate that about her. She's
yeah,
a, she's
that's
a good,
good. I hope she can carry the conversation because after, so you invented these pants for women, and I'm out.
She used to be
a pretty clever story.
No, actually, I would be interested in how she grew the business.
You mentioned the Regular Guys. She used to be on the Dick and Justice show, too.
Oh, really?
Yeah, she'd come in on the afternoon.
How'd they
get
on that
show?
Dick and Justice.
Oh, they were good, man. Where are they now?
I think Dick is a writer at CNN, I believe.
Oh, good. Good for him.
I'm not sure where Justice is.
They're with DC and Bubba.
Yeah. Justice his real name.
Was Justice.
Buford T, innit?
Buford T. Justice. Yeah. That was his name.
No, that was not his name. You right. like bug-eyed sprites, that guy. Justice like bug-eyed sprites.
My dad said he used to race bug-eyed sprites.
I know, because they had a conversation about
it. I don't know what bug-eyed sprites are. I don't know what that is.
Car.
All right, here we go. Starting hour three.
Yeah, we gotta go. Come on. Three. Yeah. We got things to do.
Two. One.
All right, my producer, Jared Yamamoto. Yes. I've decided to keep him for 2020.
Thank you for renewing my contract.
Happy New Year. That's my way of saying Happy New Year.
01/02/2020. Well,
yeah, we've had a really, it's an awesome show today, but basically, what's the, sorry, what did you say
it's,
there?
It's always a bunch of numbers.
I know, but you got the 01 and the 02, and then you got the 20 and the 20. It's like the ones and the twos and the noughts today.
And you know what's weird about tomorrow? It's going to be 01/03/2.
Yeah, but but the street doesn't out. Follow one, does that's what I'm saying. 01/02/2020.
When's it going to be 18/19/20?
That's coming up.
That's coming up, I suppose, in the 18th month.
Okay.
It will happen.
Right on.
So basically, every segment has a name, but really we're just talking about the new year and the new decade, the year and the decade that's behind us. So let's continue with the same conversation we've been having all day, but we just throw a segment name on it. So let's do that.
We've got to get Doctrine Voice Lady involved.
Hey. Happy New Year. Even more headlines for Thursday, January 2nd.
It's a bunch of numbers and also more headlines.
Isn't it all just a bunch of numbers, ultimately?
It's true.
All right, what do you got for me? More stories about the decade we've left, the year we've left, the decade that's ahead, the year that's ahead.
You won't believe what.
Don't tell me what I will or will not believe. Just
let him make up his own mind.
This is. I don't want to start the year this way.
I'll let you guess then. Okay. So the Associated Press took the top albums from 2010 to 2020.
I would probably not be aware of any of them.
All right, 15.
Lemonade. That's the one I know.
Is that your final answer?
Well, I would say that that's the one that stood out that broke through Eric's ignorance to the point of. I remember thinking. People still make full albums, and I believe it was a concept album, Beyonce, and it was because Jay-Z cheated on her, which just goes to show, even if you're with the most beautiful woman in the world, sometimes a little switch up, a little change. So, and I guess, and so the concept was that she was taking lemons and making lemonade, right?
Okay.
And so that's my guess.
English Nick?
I was going to say, I bet there's a Drake album in there.
Okay. Tim?
Oh, jeez. Taylor Swift.
Taylor Swift's 1989.
All right. Let's go with Autumn. What you got? What's your guess?
What do you have?
I think I'm going to go with Taylor Swift also.
Oh, you can't think the same thing?
Well, but maybe if she thinks it's true, just because she went last doesn't mean she has to get the
worst
choice.
$1, Bob.
All right, the winner is Eric. Beyonce's Lemonade was the top album of the last decade. Well done, Eric.
Well, of course, because she
I was thinking cumulative.
Nobody was more famous, right? Even Taylor Swift is right up there, but Beyonce, the love of Beyonce starts getting into almost the Michael Jackson kind of love.
Yes, definitely.
It was starting to get really, really, I don't know if it kind of, if it's gone down a little bit in the last couple of years, I don't know. But
so what else is in the top 10?
So you guys were right about Taylor Swift.
Are you going to use your microphone? It sounds like you're in the locker
room.
Sorry,
I was leaning back.
Taylor Swift, her 1989 album was 14th on the list. So not too bad, right?
Wow, no wonder. No wonder she's so upset with everybody.
And Drake, believe it or not, did not have one in the top 15.
Because he's singles. That's what I'm talking about. Isn't Drake more singles? Does he always...
Typically.
It's not like the old days, like a band that you like. They didn't... Every once in a while, like, you know, David Bowie and Queen would put out Under Pressure, and then it would show up on an album. But for the most part, I think that this is very single-driven. I remember, was 2019 most of the time, was that when the whole Lil Nas thing happened, or did it start the year before?
That was the beginning of 2019. That would have been right around March
of
2019.
But, I mean, that was a single. Like, does he even have an album? I mean, ultimately, he may have an album.
There's
got to
be an album with that song on it.
I can't remember,
people
honestly.
People don't buy albums. This is in my brain, they've got to have an album.
You buy all music piecemeal.
Yeah, if you're 21, I don't even think an album, the concept of an album doesn't even really mean anything to
you. Or do you even buy it anymore? You can just stream it.
Right, well, of course. Well, I mean, you could stream them or you can buy. I buy albums.
If I like it, I'll buy it.
Let's not forget also that last year was the first year that vinyl outsold CDs since 1986.
And that has more to do with the fact that the CD died. I mean,
some vinyl. Yeah,
that's
of course.
You know.
But there are.
It's the same amount of vinyl was sold. And by the way, CDs weren't purchased.
I don't think in 15 years there's going to be a nostalgia for the CD. I don't think that one's ever coming back.
No.
The album, the reason the album, you can get nostalgic about it and have sort of a niche industry.
Because
you
missed it.
Well, no, because there's so much more to it. There's photos. The album cover is big. It's large. You can open some of them up. You can write stuff on the inside of them. And the package felt like more. Whereas a CD was the beginning of.
Believe me, Pink Floyd, Led Zeppelin, and Metallica know that. That's why they put out $150 box sets.
I mean, Some Girls was. You know, the first version, I don't know about now if you buy it, but the inner sleeve was part of the art that you saw on the outside. You pulled the faces out. So it was a part of the medium you could work with, and people missed that part of it as well. CDs didn't give you any of that.
What one had the zipper on it?
That was Sticky Fingers, my favorite Rolling Stones album.
Beggar's Banquet just got a re-release, I believe, the box set deal.
Didn't make it on the top.
It just came out.
I am surprised, though, especially Autumn, that you didn't pick Adele. Adele was in the top five.
Oh, Adele.
And also Rihanna.
Adele was big. Rihanna, you know.
Yeah. I was big.
You were four.
I've been losing a bit of weight.
Yeah, yeah.
Don't need to come out on it. We all know it.
I'm not calling you out at all. I think
you're
beautiful.
You just said I was big in 2019.
Your star was rising. You were a big star. That's what I meant.
Oh, is that what you mean?
That's what I meant.
All right, come on, let's have a pint.
Let's have a pint. I would never.
Got a frozen pizza in the oven. We can have a little bit of
slice. Have a pie and a pint.
You're a talented lady. She must be in the midst of creating her next big thing.
Yeah, because her last relationship went south, so now she's
just
going to write
about it. Oh, it's going to be great. It's
going to be great. If she stayed halfway married.
Yeah, real depressed, yeah. I've got to write a lot of songs like Taylor Swift, but I won't be such a crybaby, will I?
Yeah, was her relationship with somebody famous?
I think he might have been in the industry, but he wasn't a famous guy. She married him, they had a kid, and then that's done now, isn't it?
Got a kid, not a big deal. Break up.
Now Adele takes the kid down the pub.
You got money, you're fine.
Yeah, bring the kid down the pub.
That's right.
You know, it's like a family place. You know, it ain't like in America, you know, you got these like dingy bars.
Right.
You know them down here. You know old Georgie, behind the bar, gives you a pint of lager.
English Nick, when you were a kid, were you ever taken to a pub as a child?
Yes, there were. My parents weren't really drinkers. I still aren't really drinkers, but there would be times when we go to a pub.
I mean, sometimes it's just a community thing, right, to be in the pub.
It's a public house, isn't
it? Every soap opera in the UK... The meeting place where all the characters come together is the local pub.
No, and they all look like, from the point of view of me watching these BBC type shows, they all seem to look alike. A lot of wood.
Oh, yeah.
A lot of, you know.
The white lions, the red lions, the ship and anchor, all this stuff.
And they seem to me a little bit claustrophobic. Like, I don't know if I would enjoy myself. A lot of like, not shag rug on the walls, but like, really, you know what I mean? You go to those old kind of bars in America, even, and they were just too claustrophobic for me. Like,
there is deer heads everywhere.
I tell you what, there's something about this time of year when you go to England and you go into pubs where it's nice and warm.
I'm sure I'd love it.
Shut up.
I only know it from Midsummer Murders.
Yeah.
They're always in a pub.
When I was 4 years old, my mother was mad at my dad. He was playing cards at a bar, and the name of the bar was The Pub. And she took me there and dropped me off and went home.
My parents were bartenders and waiters and waitresses and stuff. So some of my earliest memories are the smell of maraschino cherries.
Yeah.
And that fake leather that's on the bar, like that coming together. But I was usually there like in the daytime. Like my dad would do, they had to do something or drop something off. And so to me, I loved it because how do you shut a kid up who's like 4 years old? Get him some ice cream or whatever, or get him a cola. So it was, you know.
I'm forgetting that my mom's sister, one of my mom's many sisters, her and her husband, they were landlords at a pub called The Walnut Tree.
The Walnut Tree.
And it was Uncle Bernard and Auntie Artie. Artie, Mum's gonna love this. God rest her souls. Artie was short for Harriet, and we used to. So some afternoons when we were after school, we would go down and hang out with Auntie Artie at the pub, and there'd be a few old cider drinkers, and they're shaking and stuff. You know, they'd get the shakes until they had their first pint.
Like stories about the war. So do pubs usually in England? Do they usually have decent food, or
it's gotten better. Like nowadays,
You
can get your mushy peas and your fish and chips. Yeah, the food. Some of the pubs are now more well known for their food.
Are
than
they
their
still
beer.
Now? Really? My guess now would it be here? Like my guess is back then it was always Auntie Artie and somebody who owned the pub. Are there corporations that own them and open them all across?
I'm going to get this wrong, I know, but there's massive corporate breweries who own a lot of the pubs now.
Yeah.
And then if you are the landlord, you work for that brewery. Yeah. But there are also, they're called free houses, where that's somebody who just owns the pub, I believe.
Right.
Well, but I'm not sure how many of those exist still.
But it's important to people that they know the person behind the bar, right?
Like,
you
absolutely
know who that guy is, and he lives near you, and you're part of his life. Do you ever spend time in bar? You have a little bit of a
Of course I spend time in the bar.
Sketchy past like I do.
A couple of divorces and he was in the
bar. No, he means as a kid.
As a kid a little bit. I remember some moments like that, but my parents were notorious for dumping me off in the nursery. I remember that was always the worst. Like they would, I remember there would be
you were a pain.
We would go to this.
You were a pain. They wanted to have fun.
Oh, get, absolutely.
Drop the kid off.
There was a... There was a gym that they always went to in downtown Chattanooga called the Sports Barn. I don't know if it's still there or not. Gym called the Sports Barn, right?
And, that's what they said.
Barn.
Yeah, Sports Barn.
Okay.
Yeah. And one of the things that they would do is they paid so much for their membership there. My mom and my stepdad at the time, they paid so much for their membership that I realize now as an adult that they would drop me off at Sports Barn at the nursery there, and it was so boring. I was probably 6-7 years old, way too old for the toys to play with. And they would go out, and I would wonder why they would come back and they would stink. I'm like, well, what is going on?
Yeah,
like,
now it's just...
I smell something. Like, something smells different. Why does mom smell like that? Like, what's going on? Where have they been?
You smell like the bar mat.
Yeah, so shut up.
So I now,
right, get
now
the
I
back
know,
seat. I'm driving
now,
you home.
So now I know as an adult that not only was sports bar being taken advantage of, but they were just dumping me off and they were jumping around downtown Chattanooga, going to all these different bars.
They didn't have like a video game or something you would have enjoyed.
Oh no, not at all. They would always
like
have
and...
Nickelodeon. Yeah, it would be blocks, and they would give you like a deck of cards. And the other kids that were in there were, I don't know, like 2 and 3, and I'm 7, and I'm like, okay.
It's the opposite of Jared's life now. Now he's in a room with everybody who's older than him.
Right.
Back then, he was the oldest kid in the sports barn.
That's hilarious. Did you ever complain to your parents? I don't like going
of
there.
Of course I complained about it. There was a really cool park. There was a really cool park across the river called Coolidge Park, and it had like a Ferris wheel, and it had all this open space.
Oh, so you can look at that through the window.
And I always was like, I want to go there. That's where I want to go. But no, they locked me up in the sports barn.
Shut up. You're crimping our style, kid. We want to have some fun.
I actually forgot that we were doing a segment there. It just became
just talking.
All right.
That's all right. It's the Happy New Year.
All right. For our last story here for the last segment, you have, here are your choices. The decade the Kardashians took over everything. You have the top 10. Where is it up here? This thing's so long. These are the top 10 hottest destinations billionaires are traveling to in 2020 and beyond.
Who cares?
Then
I do.
Power Rising. These are the women to watch in 2020.
Give me the first one. It'll be more fun.
Billionaires will be fun.
Okay, cool. All right,
you can be a billionaire. Oh, you think the Kardashians will be more fun?
That's all right. I'll be a billionaire.
Yeah, just be a billionaire.
Same difference that you're billionaires.
All right, here
can
we
I
go.
Can I be Southern billionaire?
No, be a.
You know, because it's always the opposite, right? We're trying to be like.
Real quick, when I was home in England in November, there's a show called I'm a Celebrity, Get Me Out of Here. So it's Get Me Out of the Jungle or something. Bruce Jenner was part of, he was in the jungle.
Caitlin, please.
Caitlin.
Was she Caitlin or Bruce?
No, she was Caitlin. Caitlin was
funny?
In the jungle.
All these people are
and
just.
And Caitlin was really great. Like,
of course.
She was great.
Caitlin used to be Bruce, who was an Olympic medalist.
That. I know that. But anyway.
Yeah, sure I was. Hi.
Well, they just can't live without cameras around them, can they?
Oh, well, Courtney left.
I thought she was fired.
Well, yeah.
Kim fired her.
Oh, huh? She did?
Yeah, they fired her because she wasn't
interested.
You're not doing enough to support us.
Well, then that means you're doing well.
Yeah.
Here we go. Starting seg two.
She's back with her boy. I'm surprised. Okay, sorry.
3, 2, 1.
So my guess is you have yet another story that concerns either English pubs, which that was a great conversation, or something else that marks the transition from the decade behind us to the decade in front of us.
I can't believe that Paul Skittles didn't chime in during that conversation.
I was busy, but I love 2020. My favorite thing about it is finally... The Conservatives have a huge majority, and my dad will finally be happy.
So, Paul Skittles, you want a quick Brexit?
I want a quick Brexit because I'll get more jobs, and there'll be less people coming from other countries to pick up the Skittle pins.
Okay, Paul Skittles.
Job security for Paul.
Oh. Yes, there'll always be the Skittle pins to be picked up. Well, you have a story?
Yeah, this one's from Business Insider. These are the 10 hottest destinations billionaires are traveling to in 2020 and beyond.
This is important to me. I got to work out my vacation.
You're almost there, So
where am I taking my family to?
Eric, 1% bonus. Yes.
Excuse me, 1% of the 1%.
Oh, excuse me.
I think the most shocking one is number 6, Antarctica.
Well, that's not shocking because that's where you get these people who are so rich that they're so secure in life. Like this Richard Branson who owns Virgin, who goes up on hot air balloons and tries to kill himself all the time. So that's what it is. It's like everything is so that you actually try to make your life difficult. Some of the, I wouldn't. If I was a billionaire, I'd buy an island and you guys would be invited a couple times a year. And other than that, I'd just enjoy myself.
Number one, England, believe it or not.
England!
Billionaires like to go there.
Paul Skittles!
Go play Skittles at me pub, Mr. Rich Man!
Happy 2020!
Oh my gosh.
Oh. What was that music? I liked it.
That's Black Keys. Yeah. Oh, Shaky that. Knees this year, too.
Next year.
Oh, my gosh. Yeah. Sorry. I was in the 2020 mindset.
He's already in 2020.
I find that a lot of those, even rock and roll doesn't have a whole lot of new. Is Post Malone there? Or is he even rock and
Post
roll?
Post Malone's going to be a hangout
he's
the following
doing some
week.
Festivals.
Is he considered rock and roll?
No.
I hate that Ozzy song when he's on because it's Ozzy and then it's rapping, auto-tune.
Did you see the American Ozzy on the American Music Awards a few weeks ago? No. So it's Post Malone and Travis Scott. They're up front rapping to start with. Smoking pyro. Ozzy's sitting on his big old, looks like a stone throne in the back.
Like a throne, yeah.
And before he gets to his chorus part, he's just back there like this.
I love it.
Dude, just sit still and be like the Prince of Darkness we know you can be.
Yeah, no. Oh. Ozzy never had much on stage. He's got the waving thing.
Yeah.
He'll go down and touch the floor.
They gave him a hose in his concerts.
Water. Yeah. He holds himself off because he likes to urinate during the show.
There's a new documentary about him and Sabbath, and apparently he was like a millionaire.
He hates them.
He was a millionaire straight out the box because Sabbath was so successful
right.
in the beginning.
Yeah.
You know?
But so Sabbath wasn't his band.
No,
Sabbath
Tony's.
Was Tony's yeah. band, and yeah. They had a lot. They did not get along at all.
They kick him out?
They still don't know.
I don't know if they kicked him out or if he left.
No, they kicked him out because of his drug use.
Okay.
And, I mean, they were all doing drugs, but Ozzy was off the...
And then he went and had a bigger song than anybody's ever had out of that, which is crazy.
He was in a hotel room, like, about to drink himself into oblivion, and Sharon shows up and saves him.
Right.
You know, they weren't married yet.
Then she tried to kill him. He tried to kill her. And then, but she was like, okay, that'll probably never happen again.
Then cheated on her with the old hired hairdresser. And then he said he was a sex addict.
I don't know who it was, but I thought it was Sharon. Just saying.
He's still going to be coming May 27th.
Yeah,
State Farm.
Yeah.
Come watch me stand.
Be like
how
Collins.
Old is he?
This is him.
71. I believe. Just turned 71 of them.
My dad is 70.
Well, yeah, it'll be wet.
Your dad's opening for him, I believe.
Yeah. He's going to be talking to you about...
we got to get rid of this Trump.
Yeah.
All this
Hey, mate, I got Republicans who listen to me, mate.
Hey, mate, look what I said. No politics.
Yeah, Oldham, your dad's got more time on his hands this time of year right now. He's not doing he doesn't do the Santa thing.
He doesn't do the Santa anymore.
Yeah, I know. No. How many years is it? Do you stay in touch? It could be long. You could be sad about that. For years and years, his whole Christmas season was being Santa.
No, he's grateful because now he doesn't have to
leave.
Be away from the family.
Okay, all right.
From before Thanksgiving until Christmas
Day. That was
Day.
A little bit of his identity, though. Was his, he was like
yeah, now he's
one
the
of the top
man.
Santas.
You still have the beard?
Oh, no, that's gone.
Okay.
He does eBay now. He makes a ton of money selling on eBay.
A lot of people who have time on their hands, they do that.
Gross, I guess, or go to rummage sales.
What, do they turn things around? Is that what? How does that work?
Yeah, he goes to garage sales and, you know, all that stuff, and then picks out what he thinks is worth something, and then he sells it for more than he paid for it.
Too much time.
Which doesn't sound fair.
Ticking away.
That's one of my favorite songs.
Mine too. What? Sticks.
Yeah.
What?
I like that song.
It's one of the worst things
I've ever heard. I'm not a fan.
I am a fan of, like, when I was a kid, I loved The Grand Illusion. I still think that's a cool album.
Isn't it on that album?
No.
It's on Double Fan. It's Paradise.
Paradise. That's when they started to suck. Paradise Theater was the warning.
Which one's that?
That was the warning.
Before
we got Mr. Roboto.
Yeah. That was the album before Kilroy was here.
Yeah.
Oh, my goodness.
Kilroy.
I mean, Cornerstone wasn't that good, but it had Babe and all that.
I'm younger,
Grand Illusion.
I love those records.
Lady.
Grand Illusion. Now, that was before. Lady is like 72 or 73.
Sweet Madam Blue.
But Grand Illusion, come on. It's you.
Oh, yeah, I know.
Miss America. When I was a kid, I was like 14, 15. Man, oh, man, I would blast that one.
So you were 17 when I'm 12, and I'm going and picking up Paradise Theater, whatever that album
was.
Yeah,
I knew it was crap.
But I loved it. I was like, oh, and then you turn it over, and you could see the naked lady carved into the record.
What happened to Styx? Cool. Well? I never heard that record because I never went. I thought Paradise Theater was such a horrible song.
What songs are on there?
Too Much Time in My Hands.
Oh, yeah.
That was a big hit.
Well, a couple more hits.
Yeah, then we got Kilroy was here.
I like that too.
What?
I was 13. Who's not going to like that
you
at 13?
Like Mr. Roboto.
I was 13. It's a robot. No, it's science fiction.
I'm not talking about when people rediscovered Mr. Roboto and it became an ironic thing to love. I'm talking about when it dropped. People.
I was
just
in the
thought,
demo for it.
Oh my goodness, what happened to this band? These are the people who did Come Sail Away.
They all hated except for Dennis DeYoung.
They just got into that 80s thing. Well, yeah. So was Paradise Theater. Remember the videos?
Yeah.
He shows up like he's wearing that barbershop quartet red, white stripe thing. And blah, it was like, okay, look, Dennis DeYoung, it went to his head.
And then a solo album?
He's got a new solo album coming out in 2020.
No, well, he only had one that ever had a hit on it.
Did he have a hit?
Desert Moon.
Is this the trend to Desert Moon was all she said.
It's a great Dennis DeYoung
impression. All right, we got to go because I got things to do.
Ah, yeah, me too.
Right.
Got to go to see it. Come see me at the Windward Parkway Walmart with Clark Howard for Clark's Christmas Kids.
I'm batting cleanup after you.
That's right. Well, you should show up a little bit before.
I will. I'm going to bring, we'll do some Facebook Live.
Crosstalk.
I'll be at the one in Lilburn Sunday afternoon, noon until 2. Doing
and Sunday, I will be somewhere else. I don't know which one. I don't think I'll be in, I think I'm in somewhere else.
And Jared, your buddy is playing at Mosh for Tots at the Highlander tonight.
Yes, he is.
So bring on Raptoids for $5. All these great metal bands at the Highlander 2 nights in a row.
Who's
Mosh for
buddy?
Tots.
My buddy Kendrick. He's part of
Violent System.
Violent System. That's
great
exactly
band.
Right.
Yeah.
All right, go see them. I'm sure they're socialists, so they'll let you in for free.
No, absolutely not. No, these are not the socialists.
Right,
these are capitalists to the core.
Okay,
Bosh for Tots.
All right, we'll talk to you on Monday.
I don't believe Jeremy Corbyn will lead the Labour Party much longer.